On the surface, it might appear to you that of course electric vehicles are greener, because they create no emissions. Unlike gasoline-powered cars, no fossil fuels are being burned in its engine. So understandably, they're not going to be spewing out all kinds of polluting gases from the tailpipe, like carbon dioxide, nitrogen oxides, and unburned hydrocarbons that pollute the atmosphere. Electric cars don't even have tailpipes. But this is not the whole story. To really understand whether they are less polluting overall, we have to take a look at the bigger picture. Don't forget that they consume electricity. That electricity, depending on the fuel source, can produce greenhouse gases. And don't forget that manufacturing the various components of the car, like the batteries and other components, also requires energy and resources. Could it be that manufacturing the advanced batteries and other components that go into these cars creates greenhouse gases that offsets any potential savings from burning gasoline? We'll take a detailed look at that and give you a verdict. That's coming up right now. Now, before we start, I want to give a big shout out to Magellan TV, our sponsor. It's a hidden jewel that gives me inspiration. The series that inspired this video is called Climate Challenge. It's a three-episode series in which ancient climate expert Suwan Davies of Swansea University in the UK investigates the world's climate on the front lines from Greenland to the Maldives and shows how they are connected even though they are on opposite sides of Earth. Magellan TV is the highest rated documentary streaming app on Google Play. They have the largest collection of space and science shows anywhere with more than 20 hours of new content added weekly. Magellan has a special offer for Arvind Ash viewers. Right now, your first month is free. All you need to do is click the link in the description and start enjoying the highest quality documentaries available, including free 4K videos and never any ads. And you'll be supporting our channel when you sign up. So I really appreciate that. Now, back to the show. The climate is changing, whether we like it or not. There is some controversy about what causes climate change, but very few people dispute that there is a change happening. And any way you look at it, the emissions from gasoline-powered vehicles, that's petrol-powered to some of our international audience, do not help. These cars pollute, and they emit greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide. This is not only bad for the environment, but also for your health. So this is something we should all be aware of, if not care deeply about. We'll focus on comparing electric vehicles, or EVs, with gasoline-powered cars in this video. About 70 million new cars and light trucks are sold each year around the world. Although the number of electric vehicles being sold is increasing, it still only accounts for about 9%, which is a relatively small share of the total number. And overall, there are about 1.25 billion cars and light trucks in use around the world. And currently, only about 18 million of these are EVs. So they make up an even more minuscule portion of the total number of personal vehicles on the road. Only about 1.4%. So a full 98% or so of cars and light trucks in the world are gasoline or diesel powered. To understand why gasoline cars pollute, let's take a look at how they work. The heart of the engine is the internal combustion engine. Power is produced from chemical energy. Very simply, you take some fuel, typically gasoline, which is a combination of different hydrocarbons, the most common of which are octane and heptane. These molecules react with oxygen from the atmosphere to produce carbon dioxide and water, both of which are greenhouse gases. However, they play different roles. Increased CO2 levels cause climate change, whereas increased water vapor levels are caused by climate change. The water vapor is not a problem because Earth has a very large water cycle, given its vast oceans. And so water vapor can be easily recycled or absorbed. At a given average temperature, average water vapor levels in the atmosphere remain relatively constant because water condenses and rains out of the atmosphere. The main issue is carbon dioxide. There are other minor pollutants as well. Not only are pollutants and greenhouse gases produced, but the common four-stroke internal combustion engine overall is quite inefficient. There are four cycles or strokes involved in the combustion process. You'll notice that power is only produced in one of the four strokes of the engine cycle. So we have spent energy during three of the four strokes, taking in air and fuel, compressing this mixture, and expelling the exhaust gases without gaining any energy from these three cycles. Instead, we lose energy in these processes through friction, heat, and kinetic energy. In addition, there are energy losses in the transmission system, which converts the power from the linear motion of the cylinder to the rotational motion of your tires. As a result, only about 20 to 35% of the energy produced from burning the fuel actually ends up turning the wheels. This is not a very efficient way to propel a vehicle. In contrast, in electric vehicles, about 75 to 85% of the electrical energy is actually used to propel the vehicle. How much do gasoline cars pollute then? Well, it depends on the car, of course, but on average worldwide, a gasoline engine car produces 202 grams of carbon dioxide per kilometers driven. The question is, how does this compare to a fully electric vehicle? Well, the number on average worldwide, when taking into account the carbon dioxide produced from the electricity generated needed to charge the EV battery, is 83 grams of CO2 per kilometer driven. This is a difference of 119 grams of CO2 in favor of electric vehicles. I want to point out that this 83 grams of carbon dioxide per kilometer number can vary from near 0 grams in a country like Iceland, where all the electricity comes from green sources such as hydrothermal, to 187 grams of carbon dioxide in a country like India, where much of the electricity is generated from coal. So the greenness of electric cars depends in large part on the source of fuel for the electricity produced in a particular country. But given that electric vehicles always produce less CO2 than gasoline vehicles, this should be a slam dunk, right? Well, it's not, because this is not the whole picture. To be accurate, we have to take into account the CO2 generated during the manufacturing process of electric vehicles, and in particular, the battery pack, which is a resource-intensive process. The main battery type used in EVs today is a lithium-ion battery, and the mining and refining of lithium uses a lot of energy and creates a carbon footprint. This has to be taken into account. It turns out that it's more expensive and takes more resources and energy to build an electric vehicle than a gasoline vehicle. The production of a typical gasoline car releases around 7 tons of carbon dioxide, whereas manufacturing a similar-sized electric car releases a little over 10 tons. The difference boils down to battery production, which alone produces around 4 to 5 tons of CO2. Some of this is made up for by the fact that manufacturing the rest of the electric vehicle takes less energy than gasoline cars because they're mechanically simpler. But overall, EV manufacturing still produces about 3 tons or 43% more CO2. So what this means is that electric vehicles, even though they produce on average 119 fewer grams of CO2 per kilometer, they are not greener compared to gasoline-powered cars from day one, when considering that they have a substantially larger carbon footprint at birth. So we have to consider how long, or how many kilometers, they would need to be driven in order to make up for the higher CO2 generated during their production. We can do some simple math to calculate this. 3 tons is equal to 3 million grams. We divide this by 119 grams per kilometer, and we get 25,210 kilometers. This means that on average, an EV breaks even in terms of CO2 produced after it has been driven 25,210 kilometers, which is also 15,665 miles. The distance driven per year varies widely in different countries. The average American drives 14,263 miles, or 23,000 kilometers per year. So they would break even after about 13 months. The average Italian, however, drives only 7,700 kilometers per year, so it would take them more than 3 years to break even. Prior to this time frame, there is no net CO2 saved. But experts estimate that the average EV battery will last at least 200,000 kilometers, so over the life of the vehicle, in most countries, an EV will be greener. Now, there are a few exceptions to this. There are, in fact, at least 5 countries where, on average, EVs will not be greener, even over their lifetime. This is because the fuel source of electricity is largely coal or other high CO2 producing sources. Those countries are India, Estonia, Poland, Czechia, and Bulgaria. Electricity generators running fossil fuels can produce anywhere from 250 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour when burning diesel to run a generator, up to 800 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour burning coal to run a steam engine generator. Cars generally will not be as efficient as generators because generators always run at their most efficient RPM. But it's probably not much worse than 400 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour for most cars. So in most cases, cars tend to produce more CO2 per kilowatt hour, depending on how the electricity is generated. So to accurately figure out whether your electric vehicle would be greener, you would have to look at your individual annual kilometers driven in addition to the fuel source for the electricity that you consume whenever you're charging your vehicle. So this idea of electric cars being greener in all cases is not quite accurate. They're not greener from day one, and they're not greener in certain parts of the world. But having said that, the overall CO2 footprint for electric cars in most circumstances in most of the world is better. And in the case of the five countries where it is not better, it is projected to be better in the next 10 to 20 years as those countries switch to greener and more efficient sources of producing electricity. Now, so far we've been looking at passenger cars, and that's for good reason, because they are the main culprit of pollution in the transport sector. Passenger vehicles make up 41% of that sector, which also includes trucks, planes, ships, buses, and other vehicles. But overall, the transport sector is estimated to account for around 20 to 30% of the total global emissions. So if you multiply 41% times 20 to 30%, you can estimate that only around 8 to 12% of overall greenhouse gas emissions are due to passenger cars. Now, you may say that's not very much, and you wouldn't be wrong. But 8 to 12% is not insignificant, and it's one area where you as an individual can make a difference. Now, if we look at the overall picture, you'll see that the most significant contributor to global greenhouse gases at about 40% comes from electricity and heat production. The majority of this comes from fossil fuels like coal, natural gas, and oil products. Finding more eco-friendly ways to produce electricity is the subject for another day, but one good alternative, in my opinion, would be nuclear. I made a video about it here if you want to learn more. In any case, any change in that sector will not happen overnight and is largely out of our control. But your personal demand and use of electric vehicles is under your control. They're in general more efficient, with the best electric vehicles approaching 90% efficiency in terms of the energy actually used to propel the vehicle. And of course, they don't have any direct carbon emissions. In carbon dioxide numbers, you'll create about 19 tons of CO2 over the lifetime of an EV, but more than 55 tons of CO2 for a gasoline car over its lifetime. The bottom line is that unless you live in India, Estonia, Poland, Czechia, or Bulgaria, you will on average be greener driving an EV than an equivalent gasoline-powered car over its lifetime. This takes into account all the CO2 created during the manufacturing process and in electrical power generation over its lifetime. Now, I want to tell you that this is not a panacea. There could be additional issues we have not addressed. For example, one problem is that unlike typical 12-volt car batteries, the large batteries in electric vehicles are currently not recycled on a large scale. 12-volt batteries have a recycling rate of 99% in the US, so almost all of them are recycled. Lithium batteries from electric cars, on the other hand, are recycled at only about a 5% rate. So the question is what to do with these batteries at the end of their life. These EV batteries are not insignificant. They weigh somewhere around 500 kilograms or 1,000 pounds and can release toxic chemicals if put in a landfill. This is not a big problem right now since modern electric cars are relatively new and most have not reached the end of their life. EV batteries today have a life expectancy of 10 to 15 years within the car. So what happens 10 to 15 years from now when 145 million EVs are estimated to be on the road and large numbers start to get to the end of their life? They're not currently designed to be easily recycled, but manufacturers are working on this. One option is to repurpose them. They still retain 75 to 80% of their capacity after the end of their life in cars. They could be reused as stationary energy storage units for another 10 plus years, so that may be an option. If discarded, their environmental impact has not been taken into account in this video. Finally, there's some concern about whether raw materials like lithium and cobalt may be limited to make the projected number of EV batteries in the coming years. And this could create geopolitical tensions. So let me end with the overall picture. Over the lifetime of a car, an electric vehicle will be greener in most countries of the world. They will produce about one-third the amount of greenhouse gases compared to conventional gasoline cars. And the savings will be even larger if we move to greener power generation. EVs currently would not be a greener alternative in India, Estonia, Poland, Czechia, and Bulgaria. But this is likely to change over the next 10 years or so as these countries move to greener fuel sources. Electric car batteries will have an environmental impact unless we can create a cost-effective widespread national and international recycling program. Raw material supplies may be limited, and we should be aware of its geopolitical impact. There are a couple of other issues with EVs I didn't mention, such as questionable cold climate performance, long charge times, and charging station availability for long distance trips. But I think these are relatively minor and will be worked out as EVs get better in future generations. Just like, you know, the problems with early gasoline engine cars were worked out. I mentioned that CO2 electricity generation is directly tied to how green your EV is going to be. One way to do this, in my opinion, is nuclear energy, which produces little to no CO2. So be sure to check out my video on that if you want to learn more, and it's right over here. And if you like this video, then smash the like button and subscribe so you're informed the next time I post a new video. I'll see you in the next video, my friend.